Hi, hello, this is Kaz Risk, and welcome back to Kopai Podcast, episode 42. I am one of your hosts, Kaz Risk, joined alongside Mr. Kopai himself, Zach Risk!
Hi!
It sounds like Kirby when he does the hi! Oh, no, we have another good one for you today, folks. It's our best episode yet. We're going to be talking a little bit about the Nintendo Wii U. You may own one, you probably don't. And you're running out of time because production has ended on it officially. And while there's still a ton out in the wild, they're going to be making games for it. This is the beginning of the end. And so we're going to look back and rank the Nintendo Wii U games, our favorite ones, and then come up with a definitive list of Kopai's top 10 Wii U games. But we're also going to maybe, if we have time, talk about that latest Miitomo update. We've both hopped into it. I like it a lot. And Zach does too. It's super sleek, so we'll talk about that and what it could mean for the Nintendo Switch if we have time, as well as the Nintendo Classic, the NES Mini. And all that good stuff. We also should be having some Let's Plays going up here, and Pokemon Sun and Moon is out this Friday, so we're going to have some upcoming discussion on that. So stay tuned, subscribe if you want to get all those goodies. There's Black Friday deals going on. It's a perfect time to be a Nintendo fan. It's so awesome. President-elect Trump is out there. Whether you're super happy about him being president and you just want to rejoice by playing games, or you're super, super depressed, you can just play video games, you know? Take your Nintendo Switch to your little protest and be like,
yeah,
here we
go.
That's
a good idea.
So Zach, let's hop straight into it.
Okay.
With ranking the top 10 Wii U games. Here's how we're going to go about it, folks. We have so many statistics and analytics going on here. We've poured in hours and hours of scientific research, algorithms and formulas, trying to come up with a definitive list of what the best Wii U games are. And so we're going to go through and talk about them, starting, of course, with number 10, because you got to keep the suspense going. What's the number one game? And here's what we're going to do. We're going to go back and forth. Zach will state a game, or I'll state a game for their number 10. Maybe we'll do some reflecting on either one, and we'll move forward up the list. The last place game, game number 10, only gets 1 point from each of us. So then game number 9 gets 2 points, and so on and so forth. So the number one game actually gets 10 points. We'll then add up the numbers between both Zach and I, and potentially there could be a game with 20 points if we both think it's the number one game, but there also could be the lowest score of a game only having, I guess, what's the lowest rank you could have? 2 points if we both put that number 10. And so then we'll definitively rank that and have the top 10 Kopai Wii U games, in which case maybe we'll write a feature on it and post it somewhere. I don't know. And so then you can see how it compares with your list, what you think, what your top 10 Wii U games are. Be sure to leave those down in the comments. Start thinking about them right now as you're listening or as you're watching. And we're also going to be talking, if we have time, I made a list of, as I was making my top 10 list, of my most played games. And they actually happen to go pretty much hand in hand. There's some that I played a little bit more but liked a little bit more than others, and so on and so forth. But I thought we could talk about that as well. If you pull out your Wii U gamepad, you can hit this thing called the diary log, I think is what it's called, or game diary or something, and you can figure out what your most played games are. Very cool feature. So, yeah.
It should be a better feature because, you know, the 3DS one is so good.
Yeah, that's awesome.
It's a play journal or something where you just click a title and it has it'll have little crowns next to the one that's, like, your most played. And
it also has, like, most played but also, like, most average game time, like games that you spent the longest in. Like that was – I think Zelda Ocarina of Time was my, like, most – average spent time in it. Like, I'd play it for hours on end, but I only played it for like 20 hours, so
but then also the how many times you booted it up, actually, so it'll be like you booted up Pokemon 324 times total, you know, stuff like that.
I don't know why the Wii U doesn't have that same sort of infrastructure.
Hopefully the Switch does. That'd be nice.
So Zach, do you want to hop straight into it with what our lowest ranked? Or wait, should we do some honorable mentions before we get into our top 10? I don't know if you have any honorable mentions, but you know.
Yeah, sure.
I have a few. Okay. I thought I would throw these out. These are obviously not the top 10 games because they're just the honorable mentions. But first and foremost on my honorable mention list is Pokken Tournament. It unfortunately for me did not make the top 10 list. I put about 7 hours into it, really only during the first month it was out. I thought it was a beautiful, fun game, and I would love to go back to it. I hope it comes to the Switch, and I hope they continue to add DLC characters, and I like the idea of adding more Amiibo cards and Pokemon cards and having integration between the two. But for whatever reason, it just, I mean, probably because there was Smash Bros. Like, I'd rather play Smash over Pokken.
Definitely.
I thought Pokken was, I did think Pokken, though, was an awesome fighter. Like, one of my favorite fighting games I've ever played beyond Smash.
Yeah, that's definitely one of my honorable mentions, too. It didn't make the list for me, but I think I'm with you where Smash was kind of the more favored one, and kind of once you, it's that way with fighting games. Like, if you're into Street Fighter, if you're into Smash, if you're into Pokken, it's like you kind of pick the one that if you're going to be proficient in anyone, you kind of have to do that, because it's like once I took a break from Pokken for a bit and went back in, and I also think due to the limited roster and having been available in Japan for way too long before it came out here, there's a level of like there's a balance issue there with people who are very, very proficient in the game and versus those who aren't so much. And it's not as wide-ranging online, the player base, as Smash, so you're not running into as many, you know, wide-ranging, varied opponents. You're getting more just...
And there wasn't, like, I also didn't like that. I mean, there wasn't, like, event battles like Smash has. There wasn't, you know... Yeah. Like maybe like even like a Pokedex to fill out, like Smash has all the trophies, like...
And it wasn't Stadium!
That's true.
You. It wasn't Stadium U, and that's what I've been demanding... And so,
well, now we'll basically have Stadium on the Switch because we're just gonna have Pokemon on the Switch.
Yeah, hopefully.
So, I mean, well, there's no way we're not having Pokemon on the Switch. So,
yeah,
that's basically confirmed. Then, so, well, it's coming. Just, and another honorable mention that did not make the top 10 list is Sonic Lost World. I put about 10 hours into that game, so it was actually I played more Sonic Lost World than some of the other games on my top 10 list. But I actually, I don't think I ever ended up completely beating it, and probably most of those 10 hours is from, like, that very first level that you and I were competing on for, like, the fastest time.
Yeah.
We were, like, what, like, top 100 in the world? Like, we were so fast at that level. That game was honestly one of the best Sonic games I've played, like, next to Sonic Generations. I loved Lost World. I hated the villains. I didn't think they were clever at all.
Yeah, definitely.
But the overall gameplay and that kind of... Sonic Dash or whatever it is, like, combined with, like, Super Mario Galaxy of sorts, like, it was just, I thought, an awesome game, and I'd love to go back to it and beat it one day and get all the medals, like, because those medals are super addictive to find. But yeah, I mean, for whatever reason, I just didn't include it on my top 10 list because there's other great games out there.
I remember there was a lot of unreasonable hate out there for it when it came
terrible.
Out
how slow it was,
and so Yeah. People not knowing how to play it, and so they were just, like, misjudging it. And I felt if you gave it a shot and actually got good, it was actually a pretty fun game. Doing, like, speed runs and stuff, it was great for things like that. And definitely better, you know, miles above, like, a Sonic Boom and stuff. It was cool that they went and tried to experiment and tried to do something fresh and new for Sonic, like they do very often, and still keep a lot of the fundamentals there. And, you know, but trying to take it in a route that a lot of people love, because everybody wants a new Mario Galaxy game and people love the Galaxy series. So why not try to take it a little bit in that route? You know, it's like it's, you know,
so, I mean, I hope we see something like that again. I mean, I doubt we will, because I mean, maybe Generations 2 on like the next one that's coming out will kind of incorporate
Utopia.
But I mean, it seems like they're maybe going the Sonic Mania, Sonic Generations route, like, because they're kind of, they're back and forth, just like Mario has the 3D Marios and the Super Mario, or the new Super Mario Brothers series. Seems like Sonic's going to start going in the Generations Mania route. But we'll see. I loved Lost World, though. It's also on the PC, which I may pick up if it's ever on a Steam sale. Third out of my four honorable mentions is Hyrule Warriors. I actually originally did have this in my top 10. I put about 13 hours into it. Really, really loved it and would love to go back. I think I own the Majora's Mask DLC, and I'd love to go back and play as Skull Kid. That was one of my big disappointments with it at launch. It was obviously, I mean, there's all the gripes about it, how it looks, the muddy textures on the ground, how enemies just pop in. But I thought it was overall a really cool experience, lots of Zelda fan service, and really just a mindless game to play where you just do a mass genocide of Gorons after work or something. Very satisfactory sort of arcade feeling game, which I loved. And I, once again, like I said, I'd love to go back to it for the DLC. But if it had trophies, I mean, that'd be platinuming that stuff. Like, give me some incentive to go back. But yeah, I don't know if you ever played too much of that, or do you ever pick it up?
I was never really too pulled into the whole Hyrule Warriors thing.
Hopefully, I hope it comes to Switch. I think it will come to Switch. If it came to the 3DS, and if they're still adding DLC in there, I think they're just somewhere in their back corner, they have a Switch port ready to go. I would see no reason why it wouldn't just go ahead and come. Like, it's not like it relies on two screens. It doesn't rely on a touchpad or anything. It's just a fun game. And so,
yeah. Well, and they failed so badly on the 3DS one that it's like...
I haven't played that one.
They have to definitely give it another chance, and they've spent so much time on building it into what it is with all the DLC and the different characters that, I'd be really surprised if we don't see at least a continuation of that.
Yeah.
And I would probably give it a shot again if it comes out again. And I think
if it comes out with all the DLC, like, it has so much DLC, probably more characters in DLC than it did in the original launch. Like, it is, it's packed.
And it also seems like, I mean, because it failed so much on the 3DS, but just on the Switch, inherently, it seems like a great game to just, if you're on the go, to pick up and play because of that sort of arcadey-ness to it.
Or even, like, if it has, you know, the wireless communication, like, you just have someone else nearby you with a Switch, and just go, and you each have your own gamepad, basically, to do your own perspective. Would be perfect on the Switch, but yeah.
What we need is that is kind of off topic a little bit, but, and Star Fox, I guess, could maybe make an honorable mention. Didn't make it on my list. Not really. Didn't even come into my mind too much for honorable mentions, honestly. but I was thinking, you know, for the Switch, that'd be kind of fun if, like, two people, like, if you had your gamepads and you guys
incredible.
Are both kind of, like, moving around, like that Eagle Flight game coming to PSVR, kind of, like, gliding, flying your things to the sky, everybody. Running around the room.
Lots of potential, and I think the Star Fox franchise, but we may have to talk about that a little later, because my last honorable mention is New Super Luigi U. And this actually was also originally in my top 10, but it had to get cut out. I mainly cut it out because never mind. There's a reason it got cut out.
I bet I can guess.
Because it's more so DLC. It is a substantial game. Like, it could definitely be in the top 10 list, but...
I still need to play it, which is really exciting because I think it's
basically
the only 2D Mario game that I have left to play.
Yeah, it's. I think. I mean, in a lot of ways, I do think it is better than New Super Mario Bros. U. But I only put 14 hours into it, and only 14 hours. Like, that's a pretty long time for a side-scrolling platformer. That's actually just DLC. But I loved it. I got every single star in it, every coin, everything that you can get. I don't know what you get in that game. It's been so long since I played it. But put a ton of time into it, loved it. One of the best side-scrolling Marios ever, and just an incredible game. Really awesome. Like, if you want motivation for Super Mario Maker, I think it's an awesome game to play. And, like, you love the lost levels and kind of the harder side of Mario, so Zach, you would just eat that up.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
So with honorable mentions aside, unless you have any other honorable mentions you want to throw out there. I don't think, let me scroll up real quick. I don't think there's any other game that really...
I have one more that I think maybe I should shout out to because I really considered putting it on my list.
Oh, Nintendo Land. Shout out to Nintendo Land.
Yeah, Nintendo Land. That wasn't what I was going to bring up, but what I was considering was Captain Toad, Treasure Tracker.
Oh,
which
yep.
I have not beat, but I have played a fair bit. I didn't look up my times like you did, but I got... decently started into it and was having a lot of time, and it actually gets pretty challenging as you go on, and there's some really, like, if you want to get, I mean, I guess you can beat certain levels without getting all the challenges, but like you and I are, where we want to get every star and want to not be spotted, and there's little challenges, like don't be spotted by the shy guys when you go through, and so some of those things get really challenging if you want to do everything.
Yeah,
so.
I haven't even picked up that game yet. Like, obviously I've played Captain Toad through 3D World, but I just, for whatever reason, didn't have the budget at the time it came out. and then just with all these other games to play, never picked up Captain Toad. But that's going to be a game that one day is going to be like on sale, you know, like a Black Friday $20 deal. And it's going to be so fun just to do a Let's Play series of that and just play through it and just have a blast of little puzzles.
Yeah. It'd be good to look into now because I'm sure it's gone down a bit in price.
Yeah, I think there's some bundles of it with the Toad amiibo, maybe. But yeah, also, I mean, there's going to be some other games. I mean, I don't know what you have on your top 10 list. There's going to be some games I just flat out never played. Like, I never played the Bayonetta games, the Kirby games.
Yeah.
And so
I didn't play. I own it. Still haven't played Donkey Kong Tropical Freeze.
Yeah, so people may get mad at us. We may lean towards one way. But we have our top 10 list. So let's go ahead and hop into it. I'm already loving this discussion. That's such a cool topic to look back on the Wii U. Let's hop in with number 10. Do you want to go first or you want me to go first?
I'll go first.
All right, number 10.
This is my number 10. Wind Waker HD.
Whoa, that's low.
Yeah, it's low, but since it's a remake, that's one of the main reasons I have it put lower, because it's already been released.
That's true.
They did a really great job re-releasing it, but I played actually most of Wind Waker. My experience was on the GameCube. So when it came back out, I did play a decent bit through it and loved I love Wind Waker. But yeah, and I think it's one of those required games. That's why it's number 10, is because I think it's really a game, especially if you haven't played Wind Waker, you need to play Wind Waker.
Oh, yeah.
It's one of the best Zelda games. They did it. It's the definitive one is on the Wii U. So it's like, get it here.
They did the gamepad and the inventory management on the gamepad puts it light years, I think, ahead of the GameCube version. And the cell shading looks so good on the Wii U hardware. You have to play that game. I think, and I beat Wind Waker on the GameCube and played through Wind Waker again on the Wii U. And I think it's still worth it to rebuy it. And if you haven't ever played it, I think it may be my favorite Zelda. That gets so convoluted, that discussion of what's the best Zelda, because they're all so different. But it's definitely one of my favorites.
Yeah.
But yeah, my number 10. Unless you want to say more about Zelda.
Well, what was I was going to say one last thing, but I kind of lost it there at the end. So what was it? What was I thinking? It's a great replay. The replayability, I think, is great. Like, after a while away from it, like, I played it back on the GameCube, but then when it was re-released, and I'm thinking now I'm kind of also getting back to that kind of a period where actually, like, maybe just talking about it now, but I'm kind of getting that, maybe it's time to go back into Wind Waker and just
officially beat it?
I don't think I ever officially 100% beat it. Yeah. So I do need to go and actually, like, on the GameCube one, I was at the end, basically.
And it has a little Instagram thing in it now where you can take pictures and...
Yeah, I did a lot of that when it first came out. I was, like, really on, like, messages in bottles and taking photos of it.
Yeah, I was looking through, like, my most played Wii U games, and it's weird, on the Wii U it shows, like, every app it records time with. So, like, it shows Netflix, Amazon, and it also shows how much time you spent in Miiverse. And there was one month I spent, like, one entire hour in Miiverse. And I'm like, what was I doing? And I realized it was probably just writing stupid little Mii posts. I just spent, like, a whole hour just doodling and making my little Instagrams or my little stickers and stamps and stuff. So,
yeah.
Yeah. Awesome, awesome game. I actually want to go back and maybe do a Let's Play series of it now, like, in a replay thing. I think there's, like, hero modes that unlock and stuff when you beat it, so... it'd be cool to go back and maybe try that out as a Let's Play series, going through in hero mode. And obviously, I mean, Toon Link's my guy when I play Smash Bros. Or Outset Island Link in Project M. Always had the shrimp shirt on. Or the crawfish or something? I don't know.
Little
fish guy on the shirt. Mm-hmm. My number 10 is Star Fox Zero.
Oh, man.
11 hours on record. I actually really, really enjoyed Star Fox Zero. I mean, not to say that you didn't, because it's not your top 10 list, but, I mean, obviously you hate it. But, I mean, Star Fox Zero was a game that, when everyone else was hating on it and really tearing it apart, I was, like, one of the people out on Twitter. I was defending that game so much on Twitter that people thought we were paid by Nintendo because I was like tweeting at people like, this is how you play it. And I was giving people these tips and they started playing it the way I was telling them to, and they were loving it after I told them. I'm like, you guys got to play it like this and hold it like this. And like, what was it? I came up with the tip, I think, to make it so like the cockpit or something was like on the main screen or whatever. And then like you tilt the gamepad, or I came up with like the alternate way. I mean, I don't know. I mean, obviously I didn't come up with that, but I mean,
to switch back and forth a lot was like to
people weren't getting
that idea. It was like people were just trying to like look back and forth when it was like you can, you know, you can just
tap
quickly
the minus
switch.
Button. Yeah.
Yeah.
And so that was huge. Like I was defending that game, and it was also a game that, I mean, there's public open discussions that we have on Kopai where I hated it. Like, I thought the game looked so stupid. I'm like, why is this a thing? And then when we actually picked it up and played it, I remember just that whole weekend. I mean, I have 11 hours. It's probably mostly in that one weekend I played it. But I just played it nonstop. I remember just feeling so immersed in that world because of the cockpit view and the controls. Like, I felt like I was piloting it. I thought there was some moments in it that actually were genuinely beautiful. And fast-paced, and it's one of those games that there's so many more collectibles to go back and get that I haven't got yet. That I would love to go back one day, but it's just, for whatever reason, I haven't gone back. And it's one of those games that I was, like, genuinely heartbroken at the idea of, or how negative it was being received, because I'm like, this has to come back. Like, there needs to be Star Fox 1, you know, like, on the Switch. Like, I hope there is Star Fox on the Switch, because... I know this one didn't do well, and I'm just worried that they're going to cut it for whatever reason. And I don't think they will, because they've obviously had negative games before, and they've kept going with franchises. But then you look at something like Metroid that just is almost completely dead beyond spin-offs, and I just hope Star Fox doesn't become a trash Wii U brand Nintendo brand.
I think that it had kind of a double whammy against it, just because it... first of all, had that huge backlash due to just how it looked, first of all. It was like people were complaining, oh, man, this looks like an N64 game or a GameCube game, and, you know, all these beautiful games are coming out. Look at this game where you're flying around. It looks gorgeous, and now look at Star Fox. And so at first it was getting that backlash, and then people had to, you know, convince others or come around to the fact that actually, you know, graphics aren't everything, and this could actually be a really fun game gameplay-wise. But then it was also hit with the fact that it was very gimmicky in the control scheme, and people were upset about that, saying, like, no gimmicks. We don't want gimmicks. So it was hit with, it's ugly and it's gimmicky with the controls being using a lot of motion and doing this two-screen, trying to force the gamepad and all these things. So it was kind of just totally torn with that whole thing, and that really, I think, affected it. And my big issue, I think, was I did have a lot of fun with the game. I thought it was way too short. I think that
it sucked.
It was like, I have Star Fox 64 3D on the 3DS, and I just felt that was a more spectacular, amazing,
and it's basically the same story and all that.
Yeah,
so.
Exactly. So, and that game did it so much better. It did it perfectly, and there wasn't too much of a reason, I think, to just completely remake it, or they didn't do it well enough to justify it, because there were moments where I just was frustrated in the final boss fight and stuff. I was like, it took me a bit to finally like get it all figured out, and it was mostly just kind of frustrating in terms of waiting for him to do something and then have to get out and fly out and then come back
the chicken walker and all
stuff.
That
right. And so I don't know, there was just, it was one of those games that didn't leave me with just like a wow, like I had an amazing, incredible experience with that game.
There was some moments where I had that, like I remember my roommate asking like, how is it, because like they love Star Fox, they never picked up a Wii U, so they're like, is it, will this like, will this satisfy the nostalgia in me? And I'm like, I'm having a blast. Like, I remember just being like, I'm so surprised. But
yeah,
so definitely.
It was one of the things, too, is like it's starting off like Donald Trump for a lot of people, where the game is so bad that if it does anything that's like somewhat spectacular, it's
true,
like, whoa, this game is actually pretty good.
Yeah, that's true. Yeah, I mean, I'll never forget that weekend, though, like, spent on Twitter, like, talking to people about it. There's lots of discussion we had on there with our Kopai Twitter. Number 9, what do you have?
Twilight Princess HD.
So you just push the bottom Zeldas down to the bottom.
The Zeldas are on the bottom.
Yeah, I don't even have Zelda in my Twilight Princess in my top 10 or honorable mentions. I never really did too much of the remake. I played a lot on game or on Wii, but
for me, I ranked this. It was a tough choice between Wind Waker and Twilight Princess, like which one I put slightly above. I kind of consider these both slightly tied in a way. But I did have most of my experience with Twilight Princess, like getting the furthest on this new HD Wii U one. I played a decent bit back in the day on, I believe it was the Wii version that I played, but it might have been the GameCube one. Not totally sure. One of those. But I didn't get too incredibly far. I was kind of turned off by it back then. I liked Wind Waker a lot more back then. I didn't like the intro, like tutorial part with the, like the dark, the Wolf Link and all this transformation. Just
so excited for Wolf Link though in Breath of the Wild, having like little dog meat next to your side.
Yeah.
It's gonna be so cool.
I felt though once the game actually gets out in the open and once it gets progressing, you start to realize, and it's basically, I felt, the same as Ocarina of Time, just expanded and even bigger than Ocarina of Time. It felt like an Ocarina of Time 2.0 to me. I felt like it had all those same sort of elements, and it had, I remember one of the moments, way back in the day when I first played it, when you first see one of those gods and they're like huge and glowing, it's like one of the most beautiful like moments I've ever seen in a video game. So it's just spectacular, and I think it's almost better than Ocarina of Time in terms of just being the scope and the, you know, the size, and having both basically all those same similar elements, just taking it to a whole next level in terms of puzzles and all these things to discover.
It's,
so
it's really cool. I mean, I didn't play on the Wii U really at all. I mean, I think, I can probably scroll up here and see if I can find it, how many hours I officially put into it. I think an hour and a half in March, so when it came out.
Yeah.
I tried it out for an hour and a half. I think that's all I have on record. So, yeah, I didn't play too much of it, but obviously I played a lot of it on the Wii, and I always loved, as I dug into the Zelda lore, how much it really put like a nifty little bow on the whole saga of the Ocarina of Time Link. Like, you see the hero Shade. It's kind of wrestling with this idea of what happens after Ganondorf, you know, falls, and like and what do you do? Like the whole dialogue between Link and the hero Shade, and the idea of Link being reduced down to like this lowly wolf form and being chained up and a prisoner after being like this super like grand hero in Ocarina of Time. Like, because when you look at the timeline of Zelda, it goes Ocarina of Time, Majora's Mask, Twilight Princess, and like that's the trilogy of it there. And so like it's the same hero throughout, and it's just a really, I think, poetic story throughout all three, where you have, you know, the ascension to glory, and then the wrestling with death, and being a kid again in Majora's Mask, and then Twilight Princess ending it all out with, you know, bringing unity to the whole thing between the darkness and the light. So, awesome game. I mean, and obviously, once again, if you haven't ever played it, we use the definitive version. Inventory management's on point. I think they could have done better with the visuals.
I thought they did really good, actually.
Really? Okay.
There's several moments where I'm like, wow, they really did great on upgrading these textures a ton, and just sharper and clearer. Like, of course, like if you look back, it was so blurry and fuzzy back in the day that now it's all just, you know, it's a lot clearer.
I just haven't played too much time into it. From what I saw from the trailers, I wasn't impressed. But and I was also going to say that what was I going to say? I was going to say something with like playing it on the Wii U. But yeah, I don't know. Maybe what I guess you could play it to prepare for Breath of the Wild. My number 9 is Yoshi's Woolly World. I put it was actually my honorable mentions because it only has 8.5 hours into it, compared to like Pokken has 7 hours, Sonic Lost World had 10. Like, I played all those games longer, but I know if I would have played Yoshi's Woolly World longer, it probably would be like ranked even higher like than what it is at number 9. It's just I don't know why I just didn't play it till like really like this past month or so, like a couple months ago. And I think it was just in the midst of like really no games coming out. I'm like, hey, I'm going to play Woolly World. I think my wife and I were looking for a co-op game to play, and I was like, this game is just so freaking adorable and perfect and fun and just like an awesome platformer. And so I just played it. I mean, I think I have 8.5 hours in, and I'm only in World 2 because I'm going through and getting all the collectibles. So, I mean,
yeah.
means if I will actually, like, or when I actually beat the full game, I'll probably have put in, like, 40 hours into the whole thing. And I love the Amiibo support. It's just a perfect game. It's probably ranked or underrated on my top 10 list, but it comes in at number 9 for me.
Yeah, there's a lot of new games, so it's a hard like list to make.
Mm-hmm.
I think that the Amiibo support, like you said, is absolutely incredible in Yoshi's Woolly World because they basically opened up the full spectrum except for Pokemon.
Yeah.
Like the extra bonus levels when you collect everything, they reward you perfectly for understanding that you are more serious about the game.
Yeah,
so
those are
more
hard.
Challenging. It seems like it's just there's so much to collect. There's so much hidden in there. There's a ton of replayability. The co-op is amazing. It's fun for people to watch you play. It's like it's just a beautiful, fun. The feel good is it's good feel that made it. And I just want to see more games from them. Like
yeah, hopefully they're just knees deep in some Switch right now.
For Woolly World, which I'll just get out of the way, it's my number 8, so it's next up for me, and so we can kind of just talk
just
about the Woolly World
right now.
Just segue
right into Woolly World, yeah, number 8.
But Woolly World was one of the, like, I had Captain Toad and Woolly World, and I was like, because they're both somewhat similar in a way, in terms of, like, they're smaller games, they're not, like, as big as, like, New Super Mario Bros. Or something, you know, like, where they're... There's 8 worlds plus some or whatever it is, you know, exactly. It's like it's like sort of a side smaller game, but it's still got a lot packing in there.
Yeah.
So I was like I chose Woolly World over it because I feel like just the scope of collecting everything, the Amiibo feature, and like we said, it just I think it's a step above Captain Toad. So that's why I put it as my number 8 instead.
Yeah. Yeah, awesome game. Definitely go pick it up. Get the little yarn amiibo.
Yeah.
I still want the Mega one. You got the Mega one. I didn't get a chance to grab
it.
But
and I had to get 2 of the green ones because Simba,
your dog,
ripped up. Yeah. He ripped up
silly
one
dog.
Of them. We use it as a Christmas tree ornament.
Well, if that's your number 8, I guess I can go ahead and say my number 8. Coming in at 8 to great for me is Pikmin 3.
Ooh.
Yep, 13 hours on record. I thought it was really awesome. I don't know if it was my favorite Pikmin game. I have missed kind of the older ones and the structure they had of, like, you have 30 days to get off this planet, otherwise you die. This one was more based in the idea of very much so what Nintendo's doing nowadays, where it's like, hey, just pick up, go do a level real quick, put it down. Like, no stress, no worries, just pick a level, go play it, and try to get some food for your family back on Kopai. But yeah, I thought it was super fun, super addictive. I'd love to go back and once again collect everything. I haven't done that yet. Bingo Battle was kind of fun. I think we did that once, but you didn't really know what you were doing with that because you hadn't played Pikmin 3 yet at the time we played Bingo Battle. I hear there's some updates for it that, like, you can do tap on the gamepad to shoot little Pikmin out. Pikmin just holds a special place in my heart because I played it a ton on the GameCube era, and...
Yeah.
And this one was just more of the same Pikmin. Like, and then the whole idea of, like, this kind of real-time strategy management with the 3 different characters, I guess it'd be uncool of me not to mention that. It's just, like, when you really start to look at your gamepad and look at the map and see where Alf, Brittany, and Charlie are, and you're like, okay, they're over there managing the fire Pikmin, and they're over there managing the water Pikmin, and they have the electric... like, you start to figure all that out, and you have... Alf going on his direction over there, and you have Charlie making sure he's breaking down this wall over here, and, you know, Brittany. I mean, like, you just start to really just start to, I mean, they could expand this into a whole real-time strategy game of Pikmin, you know, where it's like the next freaking Dota, where you have Pikmin and his armies of Pikmin going at each other. Like, it was just, and with the gamepad, it's one of those very few early-on games that I thought used the gamepad so well because of having a map down there. Like, the game would have sucked if you couldn't have seen your map and planned out where you were going with all that. And so, yeah, it comes in at number 8 for me.
Yeah, and that is also number 7 for me, too. so it's kind of going, flowing good for that because I also agree with what you said. Like, I love the strategy aspect of Pikmin 3, and I haven't completely beat it, but Pikmin 3 is the one that I sunk the most teeth into. Because
of the three Pikmin games.
Yeah. I played a bit of Pikmin 2 on an emulator a long, long time ago, and it was made into, like, it up-res, and it looked so beautiful, and I didn't play a ton of it, but I was just like, man, I really want to play, like, a Pikmin game. Mm-hmm. And then finally got Pikmin 3 when it came out, like, digitally, I believe, on the Wii U, part of some deal, and I think it was maybe, like, cheaper or something. Somehow I got it.
I think you may have got it. I thought I remember you getting it with your Mario Kart 8.
Yeah, something like that. Something mm-hmm. I got some sort of deal. Mm-hmm. But when I don't know, I was just in love with it. I love strategy games. Like, you and I, we play so much Civ, and I really got into it. And I was like, I was on track too. I was thinking I'm seriously gonna beat this game. But somehow I just like I do sometimes, I just got distracted, and I just need to go back and actually finish it. But yeah, this was a tricky one to put on my list because I haven't finished it yet, but I have played a decent bit, and I was at the last minute I was thinking, should it be a little bit higher up or a little bit lower, but yeah. I think this is a good spot for it on the list.
Yeah.
So number 8 for you, number 7 for me.
Yeah. It could have been way better. I think, I mean, with Pikmin 4, I doubt they're going to go back to the whole, you have 30 days to collect everything. Pikmin 2 was all about, I think, gathering different treasures to get money back for your home planet, which I actually kind of like the idea of building up, like, a currency. Like, that's why I love New Super Mario Bros. 2 on the 3DS, just kind of, like, racking up money and stuff. I think it's kind of like racking up your arcade score. And Pikmin 3 just didn't really have that mechanic of it, of, like, the incentive to go out and collect more things. Like, you just collect fruit in the game, and that just wasn't really exciting for me. But the strategy mechanics of it were really awesome. Number 7 yeah. for me is Splatoon.
Oh.
And so, oh, yeah, kind of low.
It is low.
I have 15 hours into it.
It's higher for me. Higher.
I have 15 hours into it total. I never beat the single player, but I did a ton of the online player. Did lots of live streaming of it. That was super fun. I'm excited that it's coming back on the Switch. Loved customizing my character. I always used, like, the Wii Zapper gun, even if it wasn't, like, the best gun. I just thought it looked so cool. And I mean, it's such a, it's that new IP by Nintendo. And it's like, what's going to happen with this? I initially hated the idea of the character design. Didn't really know why it wasn't like Mario Sunshine characters or something. Like, what are you guys doing? But then, like Star Fox Zero, they really won me over. And I was actually surprised. The single player is way more exciting than I thought it would be. If you guys out there have only played the online mode, which it kind of encourages, I think, with it being front and center, and you have to, like, go off to the side to get to the single-player mode. If you haven't done much of the single-player, I really encourage you guys to do that, because they do some clever things in there that they did not do in the online mode at all, just because they couldn't. But, like, the enemy design, the level design, some of the stuff they do, it's really, really cool. And I'd love to go back to it one day, rank up my score, and see if hopefully they announce that, like, your stats carry over to Switch, because if they do that, then I'll just start playing as a lead up to the Switch. But
mm-hmm.
yeah,
Splatoon, I have a ton of, like, when Splatoon was first announced at that E3, and it was kind of all those reports that you have to kind of be there, and I was a little skeptical, and what is this exactly? It seemed like I think my complaints were, and yours were, the character designs and how they could have maybe used Mario as an IP to make this a little more appealing. Mm-hmm. I was a little skeptical. Is this actually going to take off, or is anybody actually interested in this? But I have a ton of respect and really have to commend Nintendo for bringing me around somebody who was super skeptical to Splatoon, to, by the time the game came out, I was, like, really sold on it completely and really excited about it. And I think that it is one of the best risks that a Nintendo has taken in terms of...
Yeah, they trusted it. They marketed it. They poured everything they could into it. And it's really paid off. Like, we don't talk about it enough, and I don't think people realize it, but it's really took off in Japan as far as an esports game.
Yeah.
People played all the time there, and so people were laughing at the Switch commercial or the Switch trailer, because it's like, yeah, sure, you're going to use this for Splatoon at an esports thing. And it's like, no, that's a real situation there. The idea of people training with Switch and planning out their battle moves and taking it to a competition, like a big esports league, and playing Splatoon. Mm-hmm. I'm super excited to see how that evolves on the Switch. I'm wondering how they're going to go about not having two screens, because I think tapping where to shoot your guy and looking at the map coverage on the gamepad is a pretty big component of it, but at the same time they can find a way to remedy that pretty well. And so the core mechanics are obviously on the main TV. So I think it's a super awesome game. I mean, obviously the reason it's so low is because there's just some awesome games about to come up here on the top 10 list. And so Splatoon, yeah,
We
good.
had so many intense moments when we got in there and started getting serious about it. Like,
Yeah,
when we're on a team and we get in the groove and we're starting to go match after match,
we
it's
should play more
intense.
of that. We should play and
Yeah,
live stream
definitely.
more Splatoon, because
And
that's
what's
just.
really fun is about Splatoon 2, I think, is they did a great way of, even if you lose, you don't feel super bummed about it for some reason. Like, you just feel it's always fun.
Yeah.
Like, it has that sort of Mario Kart thing, or, even Smash to some degree, when you play Smash a little more less seriously, where it's just fun and it doesn't matter too much, like, if you lose. It's not all about winning,
Yeah.
so.
Yeah, well, that'll be a fun game. We'll have to try like live streaming that, because if you and I talk on the live stream chat, like on Skype, and then we live stream it, there won't be a delay in what you say, because you'll just be seeing it from your screen in the game. So you won't have to watch a delayed version on Twitch. You can just watch it with me because you're playing it. And that'd be really fun to live stream it. People would probably get a kick out of that. So we'll have to try that out. What's your number six?
New Super Mario Bros. U.
Interesting, interesting. Okay.
Yeah, I put it on here just because it was as high as I could put it with all the other ones it's competing against, really. I had a lot of fun with New Super Mario Bros. U. I don't think it's the best one. I don't, I think that it's kind of there in that mid-tier of the Wii U games. It's not super low, it's not the best. It's right there. It's a perfect
Was a good launch title.
It's a great launch title, I think. I think it's a underrated launch title. I think that it's basically as good as Super Mario Worlds and on, like, taking it even further than that, because I think it's even bigger. I don't know if, I think that it has more levels than that, but I think
Oh, I
that
mean.
once you, I mean, to somebody that's played Super Mario World over and over again, where that I could beat that game in an afternoon, there's no way that I think that I'd sit down and beat New Super Mario Bros. U completely in an afternoon. Like, it's
Yeah. I
bigger,
put
it
27 hours into
evolves.
it, and I collected all of the coins, and I got to the top of every flagpole. I think it's like one of the challenges they have. And so and I unlocked all the secret levels. I did that's that game is 100% completed for me. And yeah, and I put all those hours in. I mean, it's just that game is you gotta that's a long time to beat that game. I mean, maybe I can go ahead and spoil it now. That game's number 5 for me, so it's just you have it at number 6, I have it at number 5. It's right in that mid-tier. Yeah, so really awesome game. And as I said, New Super Luigi U is a perfect companion to it. And it's one of those games, I think a lot of people may be out there wondering, should they pick up New Super Mario Bros. U in the midst of Super Mario Maker being out there? Like, what's the point of picking up this game if you can just make the whole game in Super Mario Maker? But you can't, because there's so many mechanics, so many collectibles, so many secret passages and themes and ideas that are in this game that you can't have in Super Mario Maker. And it's a game like this that just tells you there's no way they're just going to only do Super Mario Maker from now on. They're going to have games like this, because this is just perfect.
I would be very disappointed if we don't get another new Super Mario Bros. And it's not something like 2, which you said was your favorite one, but I don't know. I wouldn't want another one just like that.
Yeah, I don't know.
I want something more along the lines of you, where I was actually challenged a bit more.
Yeah, I get that. And also, I think with you, it's noticeable. We gotta point out, what was I gonna say? Oh, Super Mario Run, and how that's basically gonna be the continuation of the franchise there. So they haven't given up on it somewhat completely. It is out there. For my number 6, I have Super Mario 3D World. And so I put 18 hours into Super Mario 3D World. I've beaten every single level except for the very last one, Champion Road. But I think I've gotten all the stars except for the very last one. Like, everything is 100% completed except for the very last level. I think I even have like the top of the flagpole for each level. I haven't beat each level with every single character, which is one of the completionist things they have in that menu screen. But I've
That's ridiculous.
I mean, I may try to do it one day. Like, if I'm going to be replaying the game, it's like, oh, I'll replay it with Peach now because I haven't beaten each level with Peach, and it's nice that they kind of keep track of that for you.
Definitely.
But I'm not going to, like, make it a goal to just replay the game 5 times straight with every single character. That's just ridiculous, yeah. But, I mean, no, 3D World would be ranked way higher if it was Galaxy 3. Yeah, I don't know. I was going to say it's Sunshine 2, but I don't know about that. I love Sunshine, but I don't know if I want Sunshine 2 right away. But no, 3D World did surprise me, though, with how much they were able to do. And we've talked about this in the past with how they were able to do way more by breaking out of like a conventional hub world theme and by just doing level by level. They were able to have all these different ideas. And so I wouldn't mind seeing that again. Hopefully Super Mario Switch is a combination of 3D World and Galaxy, like 3D Galaxy or something would be legit, where it's just like, oh, I bet Galaxy, like if they called it Super Mario 3D Galaxy, you know, they have 3D Land, 3D World, 3D Galaxy. That'd be perfect. Perfect.
Although Galaxy is already 3D, so it'd be a little strange, I think.
I guess, but I don't know.
Because you don't have to say that Galaxy is 3D.
But, I mean, it's basically saying that it's the 3D Mario, because you have the 2D Mario, which is the
new
series.
It's part of the new... Yeah, right. Right.
Yeah.
Okay.
So, that's what I'm saying. But yeah, so that's my number 6. And then my number 5 was New Super My Brother's U, which we already talked about.
What if it was New Super Mario Galaxy?
Where it's a side-scrolling galaxy?
New Super Mario 3D Galaxy.
I don't know what that even be. I wouldn't know what to expect. I'd be like, is this a side-scrolling Galaxy 3D game? I don't know what's happening. Is it like Sonic Generations where it's a little bit of both?
Yeah.
I don't know if I'd like that at all. Keep them separate. Yeah. Separate but different. Similar but the same.
Mm.
Yeah. What's your number 5?
Mario Kart 8.
Huh, okay.
Mario Kart 8 comes in at number 5. I think that it is a Mario Kart game, basically. I think that they...
That's a very astute observation. It is definitely a Mario Kart game.
I do think that they improved, like, it's so much better, like, the driving mechanics and stuff compared to Wii, which was just kind of, I'd say, I guess, floaty or something in comparison. Sort of like how... it just seemed a little more... In Wii and before, the driving style was a little more, old school. It was, like, the same from Super Mario 64, basically, but finally when they did 8, they gave it a more modern driving mechanic. It felt like something out of Grand Theft Auto or a more modern racing game. So it felt they improved it. Maybe that was because of them forcing you to do manual. I'm not sure.
Yeah.
But I do feel that in Wii it was just like blasting off and you're just going a lot faster and your turns are just way more wide, and in every single Mario Kart game before it was just more exaggerated and more cartoony, and this took it back and dialed it and made it more about skill, I feel, and about just refinement. It feels just, it's like the, I feel it is the epitome of Mario Kart. It is the best Mario Kart that's out there. It's like the,
definitely.
I think it's kind of like New Super Mario Bros. U being the definitive sort of
side-scrolling Mario.
Not 3D, but side-scrolling modern Mario that sort of defines what those games were in the past and takes it to the next level. Sort of like also Twilight Princess HD and Wind Waker. If it's the definitive one, it's on the Wii U. They've taken it to the next level. All the DLC is perfect. I think that the Switch one I'm really encouraged for. But I mean, I don't see how it's, I don't know. I wasn't super just completely mind blown by it. I'm not playing it still today. I'm excited to sometimes play a quick.
I loved it.
I loved it, of course, too. But I mean, it's one of those games. It's like it's there. I'm not on a daily basis, like being a Mario Kart fanatic where I'm racing online a ton. I don't know. It's
what'd you think of 200cc being added?
Oh yeah, that was awesome.
Yeah, that was a game changer for me.
I still need to go and completely do that. But yeah, that's true. It's hard, like, with this ranking. I think that Mario Kart 8, like, putting it number 5 for me is putting it pretty high up, I feel like.
Yeah, definitely.
But, I don't know what much to say other than I feel like it's really the definitive Mario Kart, and I love it. It's like, but I feel like if I'm putting these games in rankings of in terms of how much I personally play them and I've got invested.
We'll get a definitive co-pi list with it all, but I have Mario Kart 8 ranked a little bit higher, but was that your number 5? And I already shared my number 5, so I'll go ahead with my number 4.
Okay.
For number 4, I have Wind Waker HD. We've already talked about Wind Waker HD quite a bit, but I have 31 hours on record with that. I think, 31 hours on record with that. I mean, I played it through, and I think I even restarted it and went through and played some more. That game, I mean, we've already talked about Wind Waker and, like, what it means, like, on the Wii U and what it means in the overall Zelda franchise, and et cetera, but I think for me, something about playing it on the Wii U and the way it looked and maybe the time it was out, since there wasn't many other games out at the time, it was just like, man, I just love Nintendo. And it really spoke to that a lot. I think it brought me back into the kind of Nintendo fold, because I kind of got the Wii U, played through Mario, but wasn't going completely crazy for it. And I brought my Wii U up for college and played Wind Waker just after classes. And this guy would come over and just hang out with me and watch me play it. And they were just like, this is such a freaking legit game. And they just, that inspired them to pick up a Wii U, and then when Smash came out, we'd all play Smash. And so Wind Waker is just kind of the one that really ushered me into the Wii U era, and I think is the definitive Zelda game, modern Zelda game, definitive experience of Wind Waker. And yeah, I just poured a ton of hours into it, so it's my 4th most played game on the Wii U, and so I thought it would sit well there.
Good. Yes. Makes sense.
Yeah. Could be cut out since it's a remake. And
yeah.
I mean, then that would just bump everything up. So make New Super Mario Brothers 2, or New Super Mario Brothers U number 4, which I think would still be totally fine. But I think I personally need to put Wind Waker higher up because of what it meant for me in the Wii U era.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. For me, number 4 is Splatoon.
Okay,
And I'll explain why this was one of those other things of, like, Woolly World and Captain Toad, where Mario Kart 8 and Splatoon were kind of back-to-back for me, and I was trying to figure out which one I wanted to rank higher, and I went with Splatoon a little bit higher than Mario Kart 8 for a couple reasons, one of them being because it's a brand new IP. And I think that Mario Kart 8, like I said, it's Mario Kart. We've had it before. It's the definitive one, but it's not anything incredibly super, super groundbreaking. It's definitely was one of the most beautiful games of the generation at that time. The hype was amazing. It was one of the best Wii U games that you could get at that time.
Mm-hmm.
But Splatoon, I feel, has completely come out and blown expectations. It has
definitely
proven that Nintendo can still make a new IP. It gave a new
the
IP.
The Inklings are huge now. They're iconic characters in the gaming world now.
Yeah. The Wii U now has like a iconic IP that started out on its console that, you know, wasn't on anything else before. So I just think that we had a blast.
That's a good point.
And like we were talking about before, it's just, it's so fun, even if you lose. So I just think, like, it's a beautiful game. I'm excited for more. I'm excited for a Splatoon 2. I love them continuing to add new maps and stuff. It's just, it's an incredible world, and I'm really happy it exists. And I'm excited to go in and play more and actually beat the campaign, too.
Yeah, that'd be a perfect quote, like a perfect endorsement by Kopai. Splatoon, I'm really glad it exists.
Yeah.
All right, yeah, so we've already talked about Splatoon. Number 3, what do you got here?
Super Mario 3D World.
Oh, yeah, we already talked about that, too.
Yeah.
What made you put it so high up?
I just had a I mean, I thought it was absolutely incredible. I thought it was on par with basically a 64 or Galaxy in my mind.
Yeah,
I thought that all the collectibles, how many levels and worlds,
the stamps,
the stamps, the stars, just the charm of like the Bowser castle and theme park at the end and coming up and then Cat Bowser and stuff. It was just all so cute and charming.
And Captain Toad is just a complete game inside of it. Like,
yeah, started there and we all were like hoping for them to make a game out of it and they actually did. And it just like it took what 3D Land did, I thought, so well, and just took it to the next level. And they felt inspired making it. I felt like playing it, I was like, there was so many Super Mario World fan service, I thought, because of the world connection.
And it's a perfect we haven't even talked about this. It's a perfect party game. Like we played it at my bachelor party and we're just crying in laughter, and we played it also just co-op at Thanksgiving, and like that was some of the most fun co-op we've ever had in any game. Yep. And we've played like Grand Theft Auto Online, we've played Elder Scrolls Online, we've played all these games, Civ 6, Civ 5. I mean, you and I do a ton of co-op with like some major IPs, and honestly nothing compares to that 3D World experience of throwing someone off, trying to take their crown. Going through, I mean, I'll never forget one of my groomsmen, Jared. Like, it was like one of the first video games he ever played. He was like rolling on the ground, just crying in laughter because of the stuff that was happening. Like, it is a perfect party game, which you wouldn't expect out of a 3D Mario.
Yeah,
awesome.
And you could go and choose like which levels you want to go play as like a team, you know, and and going through like kind of a custom playlist of Mario. Like little tournament you can do, which is kind of what we did at your bachelor party. And I don't know, they just pushed like with the silhouette levels and just trying different creative things. The game is just...
Switch is going to be perfect. Like all the ideas they have, because that team's just been silent ever since beyond Captain Toad. So
yeah, and I think that's, we've been seeing that on this new Mario Switch. It looks like they're same, like you can see the little puffs of like dust coming out behind him when he runs.
Yeah, it looked like 3D World almost for a moment, like just a new 3D World 2, which I'm fine with.
Yeah.
Did I say my number three?
What's your number three?
My number three is Mario Kart 8. The interesting thing here with Mario Kart 8, and I'll talk a little bit about it. We are running short on time. Hopefully it's okay that we are. I don't know.
Yeah, it's fine.
The interesting thing with me is, in the midst of my top 10 games, I also put how many hours I played and tried to factor that in, because I think, you know, sometimes it's like, oh, I didn't like that game as much as I did, and it's like, wait a second, I put in like 100 hours into it. I guess I did like it, you know, for whatever reason. And so some games I ranked a little bit higher, you know, even though I played them for less, like Woolly World ranked higher, et cetera, et cetera. Mario Kart 8, I've put in 74 and a half hours into. Compared to the next highest up, which was Wind Waker HD at 31 hours. So the gap between my top three games and the rest is dramatic. Like, I mean, 3D World, for example, for a reference point, I do think is completely worthy of a top three rank. I have it at number six, but that one I only put 18 hours into. Mario Kart 8 is at 74 and a half. Like, that's getting up almost to that, you know, I've put in a ton of hours into this game.
And yeah, that's incredible.
I think the big thing that really got me so hooked is I played a ton of the Wii Mario Kart, a ton of Mario Kart 7 on the 3DS, and I always was able just to go through 150cc and beat them, get the 3 stars, and move on. And I never really had too much of a challenge. Like, there were always just the fun, easy, relaxing games of Mario or of Nintendo, and Mario Kart 8 came in with that 200cc update, and that made me just fall in love with the, like, hardcore racing side of it. Like, you gotta be on point and discover the different secrets and look into the metagame of like what kind of scooters are best and wheels and traction and all the acceleration inside of it. And I became so good at 200cc that I was getting first place in every online match and all that. And my wife and I played a lot of it together because she's actually somehow really good at motion controls 200cc. I have no idea how. She's like a freaking prodigy because she doesn't know how to jump and run and jump at the same time in Mario, but she can do 200cc motion controls. I don't get it. But yeah, so Mario Kart 8 is like, it. As we start hopping into this top three Wii U games, that's the first one of like, this is these are the games that I've put almost 100 hours into, and that starts it off. And so,
yeah.
So what's your number two then?
My number two is Super Mario Maker.
Interesting, interesting. Yeah. I thought you'd have that number one.
My number one, yeah, you'll see what it is.
I know what it is. Guess. Well, yeah. But, well, let's talk about number two for now.
Oh yeah, Super Mario Maker. It's what can we say? It's what kind of Ko-Pai started off with.
It is Ko-Pai. It's the game of Ko-Pai.
It's the never-ending Mario game. It's one of the greatest games of all time. It should be noted. It's like pretty much. It's kind of a new IP in a way. It's Mario, of course, but we've never had anything like it before, where it's kind of like if you could consider like new Super Mario Bros. A new IP, or 3D, the 3D land, a new sort of series of Mario. This was a completely new thing. Utilize the most perfect utilization of the gamepad that there is. It's the Wii U's like godchild or whatever. It's perfect. I've had so much. It's probably my most played Wii U game, honestly. Maybe next to my number one, but I wouldn't be surprised if maybe I have played it just more, because I've just that time just sitting, making levels, having it just kind of dormant while I'm working on other things, and then picking it back up and going in, checking in daily to see what new stars I got, going in and playing other people's levels, us live streaming it for hours and hours, you know.
Hot Pepper just, gaming with it. Yeah, so many perfect memories with it.
It to me, it is almost tied. It was hard to pick. It was really that tough choice of is this number one or is this number two?
Yeah.
It kind of really just came down to like if I was stranded on an island with just like me and a couple people, like what would I want for like for the rest of my life, sort of thing. But I think these games are pretty much tied for number one for me, or as some of the greatest games of all time.
Yeah, we'll go ahead and hop into it, because my number two is Super Smash Bros. For Wii U.
Yeah.
My number one is Super Mario Maker. The interesting thing with these top two is they're both exactly tied at 88 hours. For me. So probably very similar for you. 88 hours for both games. The interesting thing is that 60 of the 88 hours for Super Mario Maker comes from September 2015. The first month it was out, I put 60 hours into it. And it came out, I think, on 9/11. So, that's like a few hours a day for the rest of the month. And then October, I think 2015, I kind of dropped out of it, I think, and then Fallout 4 came out and completely destroyed all my game time outside of Fallout. So my number two is Super Smash Brothers. It's probably, I'm assuming, your number one.
Yep, it is my number one.
Very interesting, because that'll result, I think, in a tie then between the two.
There's a couple ties.
Okay, yeah, you add those up real quick. I'm going to talk about Super Mario Maker from my point of view. For me, the reason I put Super Mario Maker above Super Smash Bros. Is simply because, like you said, I mean, it's really only possible on the Wii U. So when it comes to like, the best Wii U game, I think Super Mario Maker is just like rightful king. You really need that gamepad. I mean, the 3DS will have it, but I mean, once again, that has the touchscreen. Super Smash Bros. I get like why that would rank above with the events, the trophies, et cetera, and what it just Smash Bros. Means to us, and how it's been such a crazy, you know, passion for us for many, many years. Super Mario Maker to me, like when I imagine the games I'm going to be playing up until Switch and so on, I know I'm always going to play Smash. There's going to be tournaments. There's going to be people I have over. And Smash is always going to be there. But I can just imagine Super Mario Maker just, if it's at 88 hours now, it'll probably be like at 200 by the time Switch comes out or something. By the time, you know, the end of 2017. Like, Super Mario Maker is just going to continue to accelerate as I come up with new ideas, as people come out with, or as Nintendo comes out with new updates. My wife is getting super into it, and with the 3DS one coming out, there's going to be a resurgence of people creating levels. The bookmark system I've discovered is just super incredible. And yeah, but Super Smash Bros. For me at number two. I mean, what can you say about Super Smash Bros.? I mean, Sakurai knocked it out of the park with this roster, with the DLC characters, with the amiibo functionality, with the customizable outfits, and having your equipment and the 3DS version being out at the exact same time, so you just always had Smash in your hands. The GameCube controllers coming back for just this game because of how important those were. And then For Fun and For Glory, like there's, I mean, these games are just the definitive, if you could only have two games, it'd be these two. But, I mean, like I said, if I had to put one above the other, I'd put Super Mario Maker ahead of Super Smash Bros.
Yeah, I think that Smash Bros. I ranked above simply because of, I know that I was seriously, like, having dreams about Smash.
Yeah.
Before it came out, and I was, like, it was getting a little bit unhealthy. And it was getting, it was very close to unhealthy for Mario Maker as well. Those were both a kind of, like, a little, it was getting
Mario
a little...
Maker, I was drawing out ideas before it came out. Like, I was, like, that well, question same... block when I had, like, planned out.
Yeah, that's true. You did that. I think I did it more for Smash, too, because I was making stages like that I was hoping would be competitive for Smash before it came out and still have some of those sticky notes that have little stage ideas. And but, yeah, both of those games, I mean, when I went into Mario Maker, I remember thinking, like, not necessarily like an idea, but knowing I want it to be a super kind of constrained level. And so that's why I made that like a little bit tight thing, and
I had some
concepts of kind of what I wanted to go for, and so yeah, it was getting those games are like unhealthily good games, like they're so good, they're on a scale beyond to masterpiece level, to of amazingness, to iconic for all of time, you know, so. Yeah. Those games are perfect selections for the top two, and I'm not sure how we're going to decide it, because I do have these tallied up here now, and we have a couple ties, actually a few ties.
All right,
we got,
so...
like, our first tie is Wind Waker and... Or actually, no, wait. You have Wind Waker as... where was that on your list?
Number four.
Okay, so it was 7 points, so it gets... Okay, we put this here... The next tie, I guess, since that wasn't actually a tie, was Splatoon and New Super Mario Bros. Both scored 11 points.
Okay.
So we have to discuss that. So
the number of points? So this is number 10 here?
Number 10 is Star Fox Zero.
All right, definitively, like, number 10 there? Cool.
Yep,
awesome.
Number 9 is Twilight Princess.
Okay, whatever. Get it out.
Number 8 is Yoshi's Woolly World.
Nice, nice.
Number 7 is Pikmin 3.
Okay.
Number 6 is Wind Waker.
Okay.
And then we have this tie for number 5 between New Super Mario Bros. U and Splatoon.
Interesting.
Now, I would argue Splatoon should be maybe higher than New Super Mario Bros. U. I would say that
New Super Mario Bros. U
should take that fifth spot.
Does that knock Star Fox Zero off then?
I don't think so. Well, that might actually do that. Yeah.
Okay. Yeah. So by Star Fox Zero.
Yep.
Everything gets knocked down.
Okay. So next up is number 5. Then it would be right because that was knocked off. Okay, so Splatoon is number 5, and then next up we have, for number 4, is Super Mario 3D World.
Okay, nice.
And then number 3 is Mario Kart 8.
Perfect, I'm glad that made it the top 3. Well done.
And then number 2 is, or actually, okay, then we have our final tie here. We have to come up because they both, since you had... Mario Maker as number 1, and I had it number 2, and I had Smash. It was back and forth, so it was 19 points each. So how are we going to figure out?
I say maybe we just leave that up to the audience.
We leave it
down
up to
in the comments if you've listened this far.
Tiebreaker.
Tiebreaker between Super Mario or Super Mario Maker and Super Smash Bros. For Wii U. What is the best Wii U game? Because I'm sticking with my argument that Super Mario Maker... As far as the best Wii U game, it utilizes everything perfectly, and the hype I had for it. And I actually think when I truly think about it, I bet I have more actual time into that compared to Smash Bros. Because I know I let friends play Smash Bros. So I bet it's my most played game as well. I would say Mario Maker is going to keep its place above me or above Super Smash Bros. Even though I've heard your argument. But no, I mean, I do see the merit in having Smash Bros. As number one, but I gotta give it to Mario Maker. It's just, it's my homie.
I think it's a smart decision to leave it up to the audience because debating it, it's really hard.
Yeah,
really
it's hard. Super hard.
So we'll leave the tiebreaker up to you guys.
Yeah.
It's in your hands. The greatest Wii U game of all time.
Copai audience, figure it out. One last thing I wanted to share before we close out. I thought this was just interesting and I'd be remiss if I didn't include it as we kind of close out this whole discussion. There it is, though, the definitive Copai top 10 list. Super cool. Awesome discussion. That was fun to kind of look back on it all and figure out what was the best Wii U game. Some twists and turns in there, too. I thought this was interesting, though. As I said, my most played months on the Wii U was September 2015 was the most played month because of Super Mario Maker. I thought it was also interesting, like, then the next highest up was August 2015 at 37 hours, and then September 2014 was at 37 hours. And so September, the November, August time is just always played the most.
It makes sense. It's probably like summer, like the initial summer hype of being busy and kind of getting going, and then it's kind of while it's winding down, and you're like, you got to get some things played before, you know, school's getting back up. It makes sense that around that period of time, it'd be kind of like, you know, just at home trying to take it easy, play some games before getting back to the grind, maybe.
Yeah, I also thought this was interesting. In, what is it here? I believe in November, December, January, July, and June of 2015, I did not play any Wii U, according to my analysis here. In March and April of 2015, I only played a combined total of 8 hours because of Mario Kart 8. And then in April and February of 2014, I also did not play my Wii U. So for 8 months, my Wii U has not been touched.
Wow.
So I thought that was interesting, like considering like, how long it's been out. Not bad, though. I mean, only 8 months. People are always saying it's collecting dust. And so some other cool numbers here that I kind of rallied up or tallied up. You guys can check out your daily log and let us know what your most played game is. Mario Maker was my most played game at 88 hours, though. And I think my least played game, you get down to the nitty-gritty of, like, virtual console games I only played for, like, 20 minutes. Pokken was about, like, the least played major game that came out. So, yeah.
Cool.
But there you go. Let us know what your top 10 Wii U games are down in the comments below. And if you think that what is better, Super Mario Maker or Super Smash Bros. For Wii U, obviously a super tough decision. It's going to be hard to narrow that down. But there you go. That's our top definitive list of Wii U games. I think when Colin and Greg did it on PS I Love You XOXO with the top PlayStation 4 games, they were unanimously declaring Uncharted 4 as the number one. So they didn't have that same mistake as we did. But, I mean, that just goes to show with Nintendo. Like, we're getting down to the nitty-gritty. It's like, how do you decide? Oh, my God.
Yeah.
I mean, and there's games out there that we haven't even really played. Like, I didn't touch Bayonetta 2, and I hear that game is just incredible. I never did Kirby's Canvas Curse. I never picked up Captain Toad. And so Wonderful 101's out there floating about. Like, and I hear that's super fun. And so, and there's still Breath of the Wild coming out.
That's true.
Like, Breath of the Wild is still out there.
Yeah.
And we just made our top 10 list, and these are, like, top 10, like, games almost of all time. And Breath of the Wild isn't even out on the console yet. Like, the Wii U, for all of its shortcomings, did awesome when it came to the first-party launch, or first-party hardware, or software, so... So that's everything for Copai Podcast this week, episode 42. We hope you guys enjoyed. Sorry we didn't get to the Miitomo discussion or the NES Classic discussion, but we'll talk about that more next week because it seems like it's going to be some slower weeks here as we lead up to the Nintendo Switch. But it's crazy as we're getting closer and closer. We're only 2 months out officially as of yesterday, November 12th, of knowing more details about the console. When this goes live, it'll be November 14th, so actually it'll be your birthday, Zach. Happy birthday. You should leave some love for Zach down in the comments below. If you guys have listened this far, and until next time,
crazy. There was a whole show was worth just doing that top 10. That's crazy.
That's fun. Yeah.
Yeah.
Well, cool. If you want to send that over, that'll be easy to edit.
Yeah. Yeah. All right. Yep. I got a couple notes. I'm going to edit a few things, I think, but
yeah.
Fun. Cool. I got to get to work on homework too, though. I want to get this over with. All right. All right. Go bye.
Go bye.